I'm a scientist. I take what scientists tell us very seriously. And we are in a very, very precarious state. Now, at my age, I've lived my life. I'm at the end of my life. Whatever happens or doesn't happen will have very little consequence for me. But I have grandchildren who never asked to be born. And I have no choice. I've been part of what has created the world that they're inheriting. And I've got a huge responsibility. So that I try to spend as much time as with my grandchildren as I can. And they are what give me the energy. Now, one of the greatest gifts I received many years ago was a recognition that the weight of the world isn't on my back. We must not carry the entire weight of the world and problems on our shoulders. When I looked in the mirror and realized, who the hell do you think you are? You're one person. Now there are over 7 billion of us. So, you know, you've got a responsibility, but for God's sake, there are 7 other billion of you also that bear the responsibility. And that relieved me of the incredible egotistic notion that I'm so important, I've got to be the one that's going to change the world. I am one of what I hope is a growing group of people who together, we insignificant people grow together and we become a very powerful force. I think the challenge we face now is that we're in a period of transition. There's no doubt about that in my mind. That the warnings have been coming for decades now, and we seem to be having a shorter and shorter time before real catastrophic events happen. Something I think a lot of people don't realize is that over 4 billion years that life has existed on the planet, the world has changed enormously. For one thing, the sun is now 30% hotter today than it was when life arose. We all know that continents have moved and smashed into each other, mountains have risen up, oceans formed, drained, the magnetic poles have reversed and re-reversed. I mean, huge changes have happened. Ice ages followed warm periods, and yet all that time, life survived and flourished. And the question is, how could life adapt to those enormous changes? The resilience of life, and the surprising answer is, was the diversity built within life itself. So at the genetic level, there's a huge amount of diversity built into a species. Within an ecosystem, tremendous species diversity. And on the planet, huge amount of ecosystem diversity. And what we now know is that diversity provides you with resilience because you've got options as conditions change. And humanity added another level of diversity, which is culture. And it's cultural diversity that has enabled us to survive in the Arctic, in the desert, in mountains, and in wetlands. I mean, humans have been very adaptable and resilient because of that diversity. When you put all your hopes in one genetic strain or one species, you are in great danger of an outbreak of a new disease, of parasite. And I think that humanity, by reducing its diversity in all its phases, reducing languages, cultures, makes us very, very vulnerable as the planet undergoes enormous change. That change is being created by human beings, ourselves. And I think there was never more important to sustain as much diversity as we possibly can. I think we have come to hate the limits of our biological nature. We love genetic engineering. It allows us to control the very genes, not only of plants and animals, but of our own species. We control. And now we come to this idea that we're going to manage the planet. We have people that claim they can control the future of salmon and halibut and forests. How the heck can we ever manage nature when we have no idea what it is that nature is or how it behaves? And I think that the ultimate expression of this need to dominate and control is with climate change. We know what the solution to the current climate crisis is. We've got to stop making more carbon. We're adding too much carbon to the atmosphere. The solution, very simple. The trouble is, that's hard. That's not going to be easy because we're so dependent on it. Oh, well, this is great. Geoengineering. So we actually are proposing to take over the atmosphere of the planet and we're going to engineer it. So this is the ultimate result of our belief in a technological optimism on the idea that through technology, we will never have to pay the price for the consequences of that technology. We can't afford to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It will destroy the economy. When others say we can't afford to stop clear cutting, or we can't afford to stop dragging weights on the bottom of the ocean because we can't be globally competitive. When we say we've got to spew poisons into the air, water, and soil because that's the price of doing business, we elevate the economy above the very things that keep us alive. As I've learned more about living future, I just think this is obviously the next stage, setting a much higher bar, and thank goodness it's there. And my hope is that maybe in 5 or 6 years, people are gonna go, holy cow, are you guys ever conservative? We've got to drive that bar higher because we've got an urgent crisis facing us. As I look today in the present out at the city, I see, wow, do we ever have an opportunity? And what the opportunity is, the way that we think about our relationship to nature. Every surface that is exposed outside should do what plants do, and that is to extend our arms out to capture that life-giving sun. We should all be worshipers of the sun. And every space, then I think, look at the rooftops, are either growing plants to capture that sunlight to feed us, or capture that energy and transform that into electricity, or capture the water that falls on it. I think all of the surfaces of every road should be capturing sunlight, and the energy from the cars traveling over it should be captured. I mean, we've got a huge opportunity now, but we just have to switch that mindset around. The big challenge for me is the way that we see the world.